Has she run? And a special warm welcome to Emma. Should we give her a cheer? I've just been told on good authority that the shortest sermon ever is 3 minutes. That's wishful thinking. So we're here. Welcome to Emma, family, friends, everybody, visitors. You're all so welcome to join us this morning. Going to say a little bit more about the baptism after our first song. And the other thing to notice, it is being live streamed, so if you have an aversion to being on camera, then stay away from that camera over there and you'll be fine. You're very welcome to stay for the barbecue afterwards, and there's all different options, vegetarian options and so on, so please stay for that. Once the service finishes, we are going to promptly put on the football. Promptly. And if you aren't that keen, then there's Shane and Bistro tables. Come backwards and forwards, and then when the food's ready, you can get the food, bring it in, eat outside, have your drinks wherever you like to, and feel at home, and cheer, and all that stuff. You know, can't cheer, I'm in church. Yes, you can. One other notice is that next Sunday, my word, this has come around really quickly, we're starting a new 12-part preaching series based on the 12 steps that Alcoholics Anonymous and others follow and find so helpful. It's called Breathing Underwater, Connecting the Gospel and the 12 Steps. Come along or watch online if you'd like to. It's also today the start of our assistant minister, the start of Peter's sabbatical, so we wish him and Jenny really well for this sabbatical. I'm going to ask Peter to read from Psalm 145.
Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendour of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works. And I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made.
I invite you to stand together. You're able and you're allowed to.
Love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me.
Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising.
Lord is growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this glow song rising up in me.
Have you all noticed the baptismal pool, which is a good temperature? Why on earth baptism? This is an excuse to show Katie and my holiday photos. We've cut it down from 100 to about 3 or 4. And it was of one of my favourite places in Jerusalem we went to last year. This is the Old City, and this is called the Southern Steps. And it leads up to, there's no gap in the wall now, it leads up to the last remaining part of the old temple, which is the Wailing Wall. And the reason I love it is because that is exactly where 2,000 years ago people would have gone to the temple. They would have walked on these steps, including Jesus. So it's one of those authentic places in Jerusalem. Lots of them you think, not so sure. But that's one of the authentic places. Just at the bottom of them, there are the mikveh pools, which is where you would get baptized if you were converting to Judaism, but also you would get cleansed. There's another picture. You would go into the water. They would be full. There'd be springs coming up, and then they had to have fresh water. And you'd have to be cleansed before you went to the temple. If you had done anything dodgy, you'd have to be cleansed. And it was many times you would have to be cleansed so that you could be clean before God in the understanding of the Jewish faith. What happened at Pentecost? This is what I believe. I don't know if you've heard that the disciples were gathering in a house, a tabernacle, the temple. I think it wasn't a house. I think it was the temple, what Jesus called his father's house, the big temple that was there. And I think that Pentecost broke out on these southern steps, and when people heard about Jesus' death and resurrection. And this is where it's thought, within these mikveh pools, that up to 3,000 Christians on that day, or those who became Christians, got baptized in that water. So you can picture the sight, you can picture the festivities and the joy. One of the differences between today and then is we see this as a one-off. You only need to choose to be baptized once. And you don't have to then keep on worrying about, am I right? Am I right with God? All that kind of thing. It's a one-off activity. That's partly why it's so special today. There's so many things, I could go on for hours about baptism, but I'm not going to. So many things about what it represents and what it involves. Partly, and I do like this about the Christian faith, when you think about communion and different ways that we have something very much of the world, like bread and wine, something physical to remind us, actually, God coming down in the physical in Christ. But with baptism, we have a very physical act, going into the water, coming out of the water, representing an outward expression of something significant, an emanation is this, something significant that has taken place within her very heart. We also get baptized because Jesus asked us to. He said, go into the whole world and baptize people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We use those words today. They were the words of Jesus, who lived in a patriarchal society and who spoke about the Father, remembering that in many ways that's a metaphor. God is more than metaphor. God is a mystery you can't describe. But when we say those words today, we're very well aware, Emma is very well aware, that God is beyond gender, male, female, he, she, they, bigger than we can even imagine. It's also a public display of Emma's intent, her travel, the direction she is choosing to go in. She is coming into the water. One of the phrases which is overused within Christianity, and it's got a bad name now, and I understand why, but being born again, as though it's a spiritual rebirth. And she is saying publicly today that I intend to follow Jesus, who I've come to know, and I'm going to do it to the best of my ability with God's help. Again, she is really well aware, because of humility, something that has jumped out to Peter and myself, that she can't do that in her own strength. But this is the intention to travel in that direction. The direction of love is a summary of the direction. And of course, she has already been on that journey. So it's almost like a restatement, a big public restatement of her intent of travel. It's part of the journey, it's not the destination. It's so easy to think, wow, once we've been baptized, that's it. No, it's the commencement of the journey, us all learning to become more loving. I think it's a little bit like a wedding. Analogies always break down, but it's a little bit like a wedding. You could say that the time beforehand is like the engagement, which the Jewish people took so seriously at the betrothal stage. But Emma has been seriously, or wholeheartedly is a better word, following Jesus before this. But this is almost like the public display from getting married. A reminder of a wedding that took place recently, another joyous occasion. She is linked with the death of Christ, going into the water, linked with his death. And by faith, as she comes out of the water, we believe that she is linked with his resurrection as well, and all the promises involved in that. Finally, the other thing which isn't always realised, but Emma does, you're baptised into a local church. And this is the group of people that you identify is imperfect, we are really imperfect, but we are a studio of love, a school of love. We are trying to learn to love God, each other, and everybody more and more. And Emma is going to be baptised into this church. Don't have to stay here forever if you move to Scotland or whatever, or Crawley or wherever. But for this part of the journey, it wasn't a word, it wasn't a prophetic word. For this part of the journey, that she is part of this church family. You're part of this church family, and we're going to do our best to learn to become more loving together. Emma knows she's not perfect. Again, her humility. Emma knows when she comes out of the water, she's not suddenly miraculously made perfect. It's part of the journey. Emma will carry on making the kind of mistakes that we all made, but it will be within the love of God, within the love of this church, again, as we learn to grow together. So I invite you to stand again, if you're able.
He has ransomed. House has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the place to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you for such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it.
Jesus is the way. Begs the question, where to? And the reading says to the Father, but what does that mean? Another question, who is Jesus the way for? Is this an inclusive statement or an excluding statement? Thankfully, we are allowed to ask questions. We don't leave our minds at the front door when we come to faith. And we can see that Thomas and Philip, a couple of the disciples, they were questioning. It's part of a healthy Christian faith, any faith, I would suggest. For those of us who read the Bible, if we're honest, there are often times when there are many more questions than answers, especially if you have an inquisitive mind, especially if you have an open mind. And okay, this can be really frustrating, really frustrating. But I do think you're much more likely to touch on truth, discover the Bible to be life-giving, rather than suffocating. And this is very different to reading the Bible in a binary way, a black and white way, black and white type of thinking, with a real certainty, this is what it means, no wavering. Trouble is, you often end up making it mean much more than the author's intended, and much more than was understood at the time, 2,000 years ago and beyond. Okay, that way of reading the Bible can be much less frustrating. It reduces a lot of time. It reduces a lot of that wrestling. What does this mean? What does this mean? But this approach often results in misunderstanding. A restrictive, exclusive, excluding reading rather than an inclusive one. Where God ends up looking less loving than the God revealed to us ever so clearly in Jesus. And I think that is tragic. So with this in mind, what do we make of verse 6? Jesus saying, I am the way, the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Pretty clear actually, isn't it? Pretty obvious? No. No. Therefore, that's why so many theologians, so many Christians disagree with what it actually means. I reckon it might be one of the most misunderstood, misused, taken out of context verses in the Bible, often giving totally the wrong impression of God, the wrong impression of the work and the life of Jesus, and how all embracing his death and resurrection are. And I hopefully don't say this with an arrogant certainty. I hope I don't say it with arrogance. But can I encourage you, if you want to mull over it? As somebody said to me the other day, actually it was the author of The Shack, was talking about these verses, and he said to me, go figure it, go figure it. Can I encourage you to do that? Leaving room for mystery. Leaving room for mystery, which I love to think of mystery not as something which is unknowable, but endlessly knowable. Just when you think you've got it, you can go deeper, our understanding of God. So, who might Jesus be talking about? There's a really good, newish Bible study called the New Inductive Bible Study, and it says this, what John intends as particularism, this is for you. Many contemporary Christians wrongly interpret as exclusiveness. John 14:6 celebrates how Jesus reveals God for this particular faith community and is not a statement about the relative worth of the world's religions. That's not what it was meant to be about. It goes on to say, John is concerned with helping Christians recognize and name their God and the distinctiveness of their identity as a people of faith. He's talking to his disciples. No one of you comes to our Father except through me. He's talking to the followers of Jesus, of the way around that time, who would read and be read to. And to those of us, including Emma, who identify as Christians now. This is how Christians know God, by following the way of Jesus into the truth and life of God. And from this perspective, John 14:6 says nothing about how those outside of Christianity can know God. And I love this because it leaves space for Christians to respect people of other faith traditions without feeling we have to impose our convictions on them. Some would call that and what I'm about to say heretical, but it wouldn't be the first time. I actually have a really, really, really massively high view of the cross and the resurrection. I do believe it is the greatest day in history, that it literally happened, and the greatest day for everybody. I believe he conquered death for all of us. Another translation of the Greek, many rooms, is plenty of room. There's plenty of room for all of us. That would be a different sermon, though, and a longer sermon. And with the football in mind, I'm not going there. Secondly, Jesus is the way to where? I love this. One interpretation is to the Father's house, the temple that we saw part of on the screen earlier, where the Jewish people would see heaven and earth as overlapping. That's where heaven overlapped with earth. When Jesus came, we understand that actually heaven and earth overlapped in him, the new temple. And at Pentecost, some suggest that Jesus is saying, I am the way, I will go ahead of you through the death, through the resurrection, and my spirit will pour out upon you there. Whatever the case, different understandings, fine, whatever the case, where we do get it wrong is when we think Jesus is just talking about the afterlife. That's probably what most of us have been taught. I am the only and the one and only way to avert hell and to secure your place in heaven, which is really exclusive. It wasn't a Jewish way of thinking. It's not how this would have been understood in the time. Where to? Jesus is the way. Where to? The coming kingdom, the kingdom of God, anywhere on earth where the Father's, God's will is being done, where heaven and earth overlap now, where there's love, it's as simple as that. Where there is love. This is the Jesus way, his exemplary life, his beautiful teaching, and the glory he displayed on the cross. What's the glory he displayed on the cross? The glory of God, the revelation of what God is really like. Love. Love and forgiveness. Show us the Father, Jesus. I am. We look to Jesus to see what the love of God looks like. Brian McLaren, another person described as a heretic by many, but a wonderful American pastor and teacher and author, says this: anyone who embraces the values and virtues of Jesus can know God regardless of their particular beliefs. He cites Acts 10, another part of the Bible, 34, saying, in every nation, the Bible says, anyone who fears means reverence, not fear, who reverences God and does what is right is acceptable to God. Brian McCann goes on to say, because of my grappling with the meaning of John 14:6, I am convinced that the way to God and the way to truth and the way to life, as it was meant to be lived, is the way Jesus embodied. a radical love for all. There's a difference between orthodoxy, which is the right set of beliefs. I've got the right set of beliefs. It's important, but to hold gently onto that. And orthopraxy, which is the way we live. And I think in many ways Jesus would have been much more interested in the way we live than rigid orthodoxy. In a song I heard last night, it said this: it is easy to be right, but not easy to choose love. Finally, thirdly and finally, God is a God of inclusion. Let me conclude with another question. If Jesus came, as I believe he did, to reveal the heart, the character, the glory of God, ultimately at the cross, love, he said, "You have seen me, you have seen the Father." How can God be less inclusive, more excluding than Jesus? Look who Jesus mixed with. The excluded. Those seen as outside of God's love. Those who are seen in that society as less than. And that did include women. And that did include children. It included the sick. They must have done something wrong. It included the poor. They must have done something wrong. It included tax collectors, sex workers, and even those that they saw having inferior religious practices, like the Samaritan, the Good Samaritan, and the Samaritan lady he met at the well. Who did Jesus have the harshest words for? Those who thought they were God's exclusive in-crowd. Those that were certain. But actually those who were getting so much wrong, especially the character of God and God's loving embrace for everybody. Draw this together. Love is the way. Emma continues to choose the way of love today. The way of Jesus, the Christ. Going to invite you forward, and we're going to show our love to you as you come forward to share part of your story.
Thank you so much. Thank you everyone that's come here today, those that are usually here, those that aren't. It's just really great to have everybody, doggos included. So, I'll pop this together, and it's had Mike's seal of approval. Let's go. Whilst I didn't grow up in a church attending family, the creation story always resonated with me. I remember even from a very young age staring out my bedroom window and asking myself over and over in my head, why are we here? And I would imagine nothingness as a black hole and then think of how God, in fact, was that unending and unlimited space that knew no boundaries or limits. As I matured, I became more aware and appreciative of the wonders of creation. To this day, as someone who works in engineering, there is no other way to explain the intricacy and perfection of nature, and in particular, the human body. It must be divine creation. Can I prove it? No. But do I feel it and believe it? Yes, with every part of my being. So people have often challenged me that you do not need to be a Christian to be a good person or to know right from wrong. And actually, I completely agree. I have love and respect for people of different faiths and people of no faith at all. For me, choosing to enter into a loving relationship with my Creator brings me peace and joy. When you see God as above all else, then your whole perspective changes. no longer is anything yours to own or control, and with that understanding comes freedom. So I started going to church regularly in my mid-teens and have been in and out of church for a period since. The trouble was that whilst my faith never changed, my relationship with the institution of the church, it was fractious, to say the least. There are so many instances where mankind has used the Bible to further their own agenda, and this has caused harm to numerous people, not least my siblings in the LGBTQ plus communities. And this just did not sit right with me. I would never want to join some kind of exclusive private members club that was only open to certain people. The Bible tells a story of love, and that love is for everyone. I've also struggled over the years with feelings that I'm not worthy or good enough for God's love. I carried shame from my past and felt that I could not be accepted until I was living some kind of perfect life, whatever that even looks like. It took for me to find my home in this wonderful affirming church to realize that God's mercy was for me as well. And as a result, I finally felt ready and proud to fully commit my life to Jesus through baptism. God has done so much for me, and the worship song that I have chosen today reflects that. All my life, God has been faithful and so, so good to me. My favourite Bible verse that stays with me through life's ups and downs is Matthew chapter 10, verse 8. Freely you have received, freely give. I've been blessed with gifts and talents, and I feel called to use them, to stand with the oppressed at every opportunity. Now, however much I am grateful for what God has done for me, I am comfortable here with you to confess that in my darkest times, I needed more than just my faith to see me through. Whilst I know looking back that God was always with me, there were times when I could not hear or see their voice. Without extensive therapy and the love and support of my family and friends, I may not have made it to be here today. I want to thank particularly my children, who have brought me joy and given me a reason to keep trying to do better. My mom, my late father, brother and sister, who raised and nurtured me. My wonderful friends, who continue to support and encourage and inspire me at every turn. And of course, my amazing husband, who is my very best friend and the worldly love of my life. I can't wait to come out of the water today, a new person with a new beginning, filled with God's unending grace, mercy, and love. However, I also acknowledge that I will still be a flawed human being on a journey who will continue to make mistakes. I am trusting you all as my dear friends and family to continue to guide and support me, and for that, I am eternally grateful to you all. Thank you.
Let's stand together and sing Emma's chosen song. To make sure you can see, do make sure you can see, because you literally won't see this again. So come forward, you can kneel, sit on the stage, yeah, do it next Sunday as well. Come forward, and if people are standing in front of you, then come right to the front. We're going to say some words together, and this is Emma's commitment, promises to God within this church family, and then we will baptise her in the water. And we promise we will bring her back out of the water as well.
Forgot you. Can you hold my hand as well? That one, that's great.
Yeah, we got you.
So Emma, do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Saviour?
I do.
Do you turn from sin, renounce evil, and intend to follow Christ?
I do.
With the help of the Holy Spirit, will you live within the fellowship of the church, and will you serve Jesus Christ in the world?
I will.
Emma, you are called to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. We now baptize you, our sister, in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah.
Let's pray. Let's pray for Emma. Gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise you for this amazing day, this amazing baptism, and we thank you for Emma's life. Come, Holy Spirit, fill her life once again and empower her for all that she needs to be in life as she continues to follow in that way of love, follow in that way of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Going to stand together for our closing song. Can I invite you to sing your hearts out if you want to?
Thank you. sings my soul, my Saviour God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Even though I'm talking, when she comes through, feel free to give a big cheer and talk and shout. So I'd encourage you, Christian faith, no faith, different faith, keep on asking questions, keep on wrestling, and I pray that the mystery will become clearer to all of us when we do that. If you would like to do that with this church, you would genuinely be 100% more than welcome, and we encourage questions. We don't preach and tell. It's part of the conversation, the preaching, and so on. So feel free to come back and get to know us better if you'd like to. And we're doing well for the footy. I won't ask if anybody knows the score. I've got a sneaky feeling some might. So let's close with our final song. Let's give a big cheer. And may the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you in the wilderness, protect you through the storm. And may he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again in through our doors.
Christ alone, cornerstone.
If you are able to, don't think you have to, if you are able to help, then we're going to get the barbie set up outside and we're going to start cooking soonish, maybe eat around 12-ish. If you just want to stay for a coffee, feel free to do that, or stay for the football as well and the barbecue. We're going to put it on this screen and the screen in the welcome area. So if you're a bit averse to football, you've got all of that and you've got outside as well. And come and go as you please. But can we give one final show of our love to Emma and her family? Thank you. Thank you.